right, great. So this is the April 17th LA Cafe. We've got a nice turnout of people here. So today, Gary Bucciarelli is a 2002 graduate of Antioch College. Sorry, I just massacred your last name. But he lives in Los Angeles. He's a professor at UCLA, or adjunct professor, and has, you know, made a couple of turns in his career since he started. So, you know, Gary, you want to just say hello to everyone?
Hi, everyone. Some of you I know and I have not seen in a very long time, and some of you I've never met, and it's a pleasure to see you here, and I hope we can connect in person sometime in the near future. Thanks for coming out.
Yeah, we're hoping we can do that. You know, I think maybe on the next Zoom we'll send out a little a quiz or so to see when people think they're ready. I heard some people are actually planning on having their next meeting in other chapters live. I think we're a little bit too early for that here, but I'm looking forward to that. Supposedly we're supposed to have a pizza too given to us by the university for our March, our success in the March fundraising, but we haven't heard about that yet, but I'm looking forward to doing that. So let's find out, Gary, what made you choose Antioch, or how did you come to that decision?
Well, I grew up in Pennsylvania, a very rural part of Pennsylvania, actually. And just to give you some reference to how rural, the Amish community was a part of my daily life. And we would drive to school or, you know, be on the bus, and there would be Amish buggies coming down the road. Mm-hmm. And it was a very idyllic upbringing. I had a lake across the way that I often spent time adventuring to as a kid. And then as I became a teenager, I got really bored, you know, how that goes. And I started working with a photographer as a mentor, just on the side. I volunteered as assistant and tech in his dark room at a local arts guild. And he kind of just said to me one day, oh, you know, you need to get out of here. This place is not where you need to be. I have a previous student that I mentored that went to this college called Antioch, and it's for you. That's where you need to go. And you know, at that point, there really wasn't internet. This was 1996, 95. And so I requested materials, and of course the wonderful campaigning from Antioch, "Do You Want to Change the World?" resonated deeply. And I was just really ready to go. And so my sophomore year of high school, I determined I was going to apply for college in the coming year. And I got accepted to Antioch. And I was done with living in Pennsylvania and ready for the college life as a, you know, 17-year-old. So I did my final high school year at Antioch, which I really didn't. My high school tried to put all these stipulations on me. You have to do this history class, you have to do this, you have to do this. And once I was gone, I said goodbye.
So what did you study, or what were your interests while you were at Antioch?
Everything. That was really the hard thing. I'm sure you all can relate. It's just like all these exciting ideas and so many interesting people to connect with that you would never meet if you just, you know, went to a regular R1 university or a, you know, typical college experience. That's what's so awesome about, you know, the days that we look back on now at Antioch. I was most drawn to, at that time, literature, language, culture, and arts. And I really was focused on visual arts. And I had never had any experience with moving image media. And I met a new faculty member there, Christine Hill, who really just changed my life. She was an incredible mentor, her and Anne Bolin and Jean Gregorick, Victor Garcia. You know, those were the professors that, you know, cared so deeply, I connected with. I started tutoring Victor's son, Emilio, and he just brought me into his family. It was just an incredible experience. And then to have lost him recently was just heartbreaking, because I never got to see him again after I left Antioch. I've never been back to Yellow Springs.
Right, it took me almost 40 years to go back, you know. I went back 2 years ago for the 2019 alumni reunion. I guess I was lucky I made that one, you know. Looking forward to the next one. It's great to go back, you know, it really is. It seems a lot smaller in reality than it was when I was there. You know, everything's so close, you know.
It seems so far to walk to Main Street when you were in college.
Yeah, probably because from the science building to the CAF, you know.
Exactly.
Yeah. Did you do any video work while you were there? Was there any?
I did a lot of video. Yeah. I got really interested in video, digital video specifically. We had just kind of acquired as a department these digital setups that included Final Cut Pro, and Avid had been around there for nonlinear editing. And I was floored. I mean, to give you just some perspective, like, we did not have these sort of resources, and I had not heard of any of this type of, you know, work that you could do and thinking like this. You know, I understood photography, and that was really just superficial from working in that dark room for 2 years. Mm-hmm. And so, like, Anne and Chris just really opened up these floodgates for me, and they were awesome because they just let you go. You know, like, that's the great thing about professors at Antioch. They're not really trying to tether you to what they want you to do or what they want you to think. The whole dynamic that makes it work is let these students, you know, explore their passions and figure out what excites them.
Yeah.
And you are there to support, you know?
Yeah. Did you go on any interesting co-ops while you were there? Any life-changing co-ops or?
Well, I guess I share this story with Anne Bolin taught Michael Moore, exactly. And Anne won, I believe it was an Emmy for Roger and Me, because she was on that film with him. Mm-hmm. The co-op story that I share is my first one, which absolutely, you know, put life in perspective for me. I had just turned 18 6 months prior to going on my first co-op, and I was going to go to New York City, and I was going there to rule New York City. I just thought, this is going to be so fun. This is going to be so easy. I've got a place to live. I've got a job that's paying me. What could go wrong? Oh, and youth is so great because you're so naive. Everything went wrong. And there were a lot of circumstances that I did not foresee. Like, people had told me, it's best to ship your things that you're going to want, sheets, pillow, you know, things like that, in FedEx box, and just get them to the place where you're going to live, or send them somewhere where you can get them. And I was working in Manhattan at 7th and Fashion Avenue. So pretty busy part. I was living in Brooklyn, and I was at that point living in Brooklyn University summer housing for visitors. Mm-hmm. And it was fine. It was, you know, an interesting setup, but I didn't want to really stay there. I kind of wanted to get a little closer to downtown to Manhattan. And so I had found this place. I was so excited. I was like, oh, wow, it's going to be $500 a month. I mean, it had no bathroom. It was basically like, you know, a 4x4 room. but I was so excited. And anyway, I said to the guy that was offering it, I'll be right back. I'm going to get a check. And, you know, me, naive, small town, rural kid, shook his hand and thought, this is a done deal. I'll be back in 2 hours. And I was back in an hour and 15 minutes. And he looked at me like he didn't know who I was. And that apartment had been rented, already gone, done. so that was, there was that dynamic. And then there was the work dynamic, which I was working for a socialist periodical called Monthly Review. Mm-hmm. As just basically, you know, an intern doing whatever they wanted me to do. Although they did end up giving me the responsibility to be the liaison with their head office in the UK. And so I was coordinating all these things, and it was exciting in some ways because you get to work at 10 and you leave at 3 and you have lunch on the roof, which includes sometimes mimosas. And when you're not working, they just said, you know, put your head down on your desk or go find a book you want to read or something. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't the most gratifying job, but it was challenging for other dynamics. There were things happening in the workplace.
You got to live in New York City. So I grew up there, yeah. And a couple other people on this call probably grew up there or know exactly where you lived or so. It's a great time. So how did you end up coming out to Los Angeles?
Well, okay. So I just want to say also about New York City, like I had a hate relationship with New York City after that co-op. Like I didn't want anything to do with New York City or the East Coast ever again. And I wasn't sure where I was going to go, but my final semester at Antioch, I'd sent out MFA applications to Mass Arts and some other schools. And I was really hoping I would get accepted to Mass Art and do an MFA program. Mm-hmm. I didn't get accepted, but I ended up taking a job in Massachusetts at a public access station and helping them direct some programming. And from that, I took a night job on Thursdays, Fridays, and Saturdays bartending, and I met a woman who had a day job as well, and we became really close friends. And she was like, you know, you got this computer stuff, you got these computer skills. This is, you know, 2002. We just got over Y2K, right? Like the whole apocalypse had been surmounted. And she said, this company I work for, they're looking for someone to do like computer stuff. I don't really know what it is, but I told them you're like really great with computers. She didn't know, she was just being kind. And sure enough, I just went in and interviewed and told them like, this is what I know how to do. This is my skill set. And they were like, great. They sent me for some training to be a computer aided drafter. Mm-hmm. I did this project management job that then said after about a year, hey, we have openings out in California. Do you want to transfer? We'd love for you to go. And I said, I've never been to California. I don't know. Like, sure. Yeah, let's do it. So I moved to California. And the funny thing is I had a friend that was living in Los Angeles. And I said, hey, can you go look at this apartment that I'm thinking of? It's in Woodland Hills. I have no idea where that is, you know, in relation to anything else, but go take a look and tell me if it's good. And I got there and literally the slider opened out onto the 101. Like there was like, I was basically living on the 101, right? If you've ever gone past Calabasas and if you know where like Topanga Canyon exit is, it's those rentals on the south side of the 101. And I quickly was like, oh my God, what have I done? But that's how I got to California. And then from that job, I met someone that worked with Apple, and I think that's how I got recruited.
Yeah, so people don't know that. You worked for Apple for a couple of years, and which seems like a dream job for most people. Wow, to come out to California, come out to and work for Apple, and you know, get to play with all those things, and you know, really on the cutting edge. But I guess at one point you just said, take this job and shove it, huh?
Pretty much. It was really fun at first. Let me give you some perspective of how this happened. So this would have been 2004. This is pre-iPhone, and the culture at Apple at that time was very different from when I decided I was going to leave. So when I interviewed with Ron Johnson and Steve Jobs. There were three layers of people in positions above me that separated me from Steve. So it was a very small feeling company at that time. And then iPhone happened and all hell broke loose. And I was like, I got to get the hell out of here, because the culture really changed. And what I was drawn to at that point was the ability for you to come up with innovative ideas and put them in place. So so when iPhone launched, I had 35 employees that I directly oversaw. And 6 months after iPhone, that had increased to 75. Mm-hmm. And by the time I left, I had 150 direct employees that I supervised, direct reports, that was just crazy. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was, that's kind of how I felt when they told me, guess what, you're going to have to hire 75 people in the next 6 months. And so I had a major kind of...
Did they require you to do yearly reviews for one of your employees too?
I mean, it was a nightmare, basically. I mean, and yep, that's pretty much, it was crazy.
Well, good. I think you're probably glad you left. I'm sure you had a little pushback from people who said, like, what are you, crazy leaving, you know, that company? But what did you do next, you know?
Well, after I realized, like, this position was not going to be sustainable, mm-hmm. and there really was a tipping point in there where I became so physically run down, I actually became ill for 2 months. I lost my voice for about 6 weeks and developed an acute bacterial infection in my lungs, probably from stress, but also just, you know, being young and burning the wick at both ends. And so at that point, being out of work on a medical leave for 2 months and trying to come back, and, you know, your inbox is just like 50,000 messages and they've changed everything. I was like, there's no way I can get back on track. I have to figure out what the next big thing is. And coincidentally, I had been adventuring out to the Channel Islands and with friends for just fun, like on a Saturday or Sunday morning, we'd take a boat out and hike around. We'd go diving and snorkeling. And I just said, like, this is amazing. Like, how do I make this my job? Mm-hmm. And so that was my goal. And I just started, that was the goal, like, figure out how to make that happen. Mm-hmm. And I really just did some thinking and started connecting with people doing similar work in LA and decided I was going to pursue a PhD and mm-hmm. got accepted to UCLA. And that's how it happened.
Well, I think everyone who looks and or looks at what a environmental scientist does, I think they're really intrigued by the fact that you're camping for 3 months and this is your work. So you did go on a couple of great, I don't know what you like, field trips, right?
Yeah, the first one I ever went on was to the rainforest in Costa Rica, to a preserve, which really was, this was still while I was with Apple. I took personal time to actually feel it out and be like, you know what, this is possible. Is this going to be right for me? Like, am I really going to be happy? And I just was floored. I mean, it was the defining moment, if you will, where it was completely clear I was going to do this and be very happy. And so I worked in the rainforest studying poison dart frogs. And
yeah, I want to ask you about that. Do you know how to make a poison dart? Could you tell us how to make a poison dart frog?
I maybe don't know how to make it, but I'm sure I could improvise. Yeah.
Okay. All right.
So I don't know the secret recipe, but
it has something to do with those red frogs, right?
Yeah, I have. So the red frogs are really interesting. They're a species of frog that actually has parental care. And so they, if you've had bromeliads or you've seen, you know, what a bromeliad is, like they sell them and you put the water in the tank part of the plant to keep it alive. Well, those grow as epiphytic, so rooting in the air, plants on all of the trees in the rainforest. And that's where the frogs lay their eggs. Mm-hmm. And the mother, she will deposit unfertilized eggs into that water where she has laid her eggs so that they have something to eat when they hatch out. And when those water levels start to drop too low, where they're going to be stressed out or it's going to be unhealthy for the tadpoles, they will transport them to a new location. So I have pictures of the frogs actually carrying the tadpoles on their back, climbing to a new home for them, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, when you think about a frog So where did you go after that?
I went to
with your degree requirements,
a field trip with my field work with doing the field trips.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the requirements really, in terms of, you know, what I needed to learn and what I needed to translate, were basic kind of understanding of how to conduct research in a natural setting.
Mm-hmm.
But also then translating like data analysis, which I've been doing for Apple for, you know, 5 years. I just didn't know that's what I needed to do science. And truth be told, I had never even heard of Darwinian evolution in high school. I had not heard of natural selection until I was in college. Mm-hmm. So, you know, there was a major hurdle to overcome, but it was super exciting, you know? And so those skills really did translate from Apple into helping me be a, you know, good analytical researcher and statistician. Sure. And then the other component was like learning how to actually just, you know, survive in the wild. We've done, colleagues and I, we've done trips to Patagonia, where we've gone up onto super high plateaus, about 4,000, 5,000 feet in elevation. And these plateaus are really interesting. No one has been up there. The people that live up there, they're separated by hundreds of kilometers and they're living in buildings that they created with stone rubble. Mm-hmm. There is no electrical. And we've stayed in these locations where what has happened is this was volcanic and these bubbles formed and then collapsed. And now the collapsed bubbles of the volcanoes are the actual only places where water exists on these plateaus. And so we've camped up in these sites, completely unspoiled habitat, all pristine, incredible, for, you know, weeks on end with, no resources. So it's been incredible. It's been a really fun adventure.
Yeah. So my background here is a place you're familiar with. I think you started talking about it. You're the director of research there at Stunt Ranch. So my question is, why is it called Stunt Ranch? And what do you do there?
Well, okay, so Stunt Ranch is a 310-acre preserve in the Santa Monica Mountains. So if any of you are ever interested in visiting, just email me. I'll be happy to take you out on a tour. It's
that might be a great event for our group here, you know, for...
Absolutely. We have facilities there. We have a small kitchenette and area for everyone to gather. So that could totally work. And the site was settled in the 1900s by the Stunt family, which is why it's called Stunt Ranch. That was a property that was settled as a part of the Homestead Act. And so they came to the Santa Monica Mountains and they grew nursery plants like citrus trees and olive trees. And they were there until 1990s. And then we had a huge fire, if you all remember, it was the Topanga Fire that basically burned from the Palisades to the Malibu Canyon area. And at that point, then they decided they were gonna, you know, get rid of the property and they wanted to give it to a college. And so UCLA brought it into this system of natural reserves that we have called the Natural Reserve System, or the NRS. And UC administers 41 sites like this, where they're all different sizes, all different ecosystem types, and they're sprinkled across California. They're protected in perpetuity. It totals about 750,000 acres in the state. And it's just an incredible resource. It's the largest university administered reserve network in the world. And Stunt is one of those sites. It's really interesting for a lot of reasons. It's got the history part of it, but it's also a very special habitat in the Santa Monica Mountains. It has the most pristine watershed running through it. So it's part of kind of a patchwork of protected habitat around it. It's right off of Mulholland Road, if you're familiar with the area in between Calabasas and Malibu.
Oh, yeah, that sounds like, I think we should schedule a little field trip out there for some of us.
Let's do it. That sounds like fun.
So what's the, all right, so here's my gotcha question. What's the difference between a lizard, a salamander, and a newt? They all look the same.
Okay. I mean, to you. Okay, let's start right off. So lizard, salamander, newt, one of these things does not belong. It's the lizard, right? Because that's a reptile. Salamanders and newts are amphibians, and newts are to a salamander like a toad is to a frog. So to say that in another way, newt is a type of salamander, just like a toad is a type of frog. And just like toads have warty kind of rough skin that doesn't, it's not slimy or slippery. Newts are kind of the same way. Newts have kind of very kind of like sandpaper-ish skin.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and then what they do is this incredible transition. Most of the time, newts and many amphibians are actually not in the water, they're on land. And that's a really fascinating component of their natural history, which is we don't know really where they go. Their terrestrial ecology, if you could figure that out for amphibians generally, like what guides them on land to go wherever they go, guaranteed you'd be a Nobel laureate. No one has really figured that out. And amphibians mostly spend the springtime in the water. And then it gets really hot and dry and they abandon, at least in temperate ecosystems, they abandon those breeding sites and go on land to find someplace to hide out for the hot parts of the year, the dry parts of the year.
They're adventuresome and they don't follow the normal path of animals.
Exactly.
I think they'd be perfect Antioch students.
I agree. I think we need a mascot change.
We don't have a mascot, do we? I don't know. Maybe we do.
I don't Horace
Mann
so.
Is our mascot. He drives us all right?
But we might put like a newt on the kind of base of the sculpture or insignia.
I think it should be an axolotl.
Oh, that would be fine too.
Yeah, because they can reproduce in the sexually immature stage.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Okay. Well, good.
We should take our mascot is Kale.
Yeah, much. So I think that's an incredible story, you know, that so many of us have, you know, have followed in our own way, you know, starting in one direction and ending up in another and you know, changing courses in the middle, you know, of our lives. So I think that was, you know, a really good representation of how Antioch hasn't changed so much. I mean, sure, the physical plan has changed a lot and the curriculum has changed, but that core values that the school is taught, that adapt to change, don't stop asking questions, and if you feel that there's something not right, then go change it. And if it doesn't matter if it's your life or your politics or whatever, I think you really exemplify that. So thank you so much for providing that insight. I'd like to open it up. There's Robert Goldsmith had a question, I believe. If you can unmute yourself and ask that, we can get some feedback.
I believe I'm unmuted, am I not?
Yes. I can hear you.
Okay. The question for you is, what did you get a bachelor's degree in at Antioch, and what did you get a PhD in from UCLA?
I received my bachelor's in arts in interdisciplinary cultural studies from Antioch. I was really interested in media theory and production. I was a big fan of Bob Devine, Christine Hill, Anne Bolin. So I did production and theory, and mostly focused on propaganda in the theory part of it, and even kind of tried to tie that into the experimental films and videos that I was making under their mentorship. And then I did my PhD in biology with a focus in evolutionary biology and ecology, quantitative ecology.
Do you have any of those experimental films still?
Yeah. Bob loved my senior project. He actually commented on it at graduation and said it was the most eloquent representation of media theory. And I was really touched by that. So then it was sad also. Like it was very interesting to receive the invitation from you all, because this has been a very Antioch-centric last year and a half or so, with Bob passing, Victor passing, and you know, Antioch has really been on my mind. So it was nice to actually receive this invitation. I felt like it was kind of a, you know, serendipitous happening and offer. So it's great to see everyone.
Well, it's really good. Glad that you could take the time. And, you know, I'm thinking there might be a co-op possibility, you know, with your connections at UCLA. We should explore that. We're trying to coordinate with other co-op students who might be coming to LA to sort of extend a, you know, welcoming hand to them by letting them know how LA works, so they don't run into that 101 highway apartment problem that you had. Today I don't think there are any co-op students out here in LA. It's a small group of students, so they're not as widely dispersed as they used to be, but I'm sure that we can reach out to you and get some guidance.
Absolutely. Yeah, and I'm happy to even explore hosting them at Stunt Ranch with some sort of lodging. Mm-hmm. You can camp out there, and we do have some facilities. I think someone asked that in the chat if there was camping, and I think you could camp out there just fine. Having the ability to also, there's some facilities there where you could lodge indoors. But we received Prop 84 money, Prop 68. We received that bond funds. And so we have $1 million to do some renovations, basically some much needed infrastructure upgrades and maintenance. So we're trying to get some more lodging out there and upgrade some of the facilities. So that would be an amazing space then for hosting, upcoming students and having a place for them.
Yeah. And see, Tanya, you had a question also?
Yeah. So did you take enough science at Antioch? I mean, or did you have like stuff you had to do before you, applied to UCLA?
I took one science class at Antioch, and it was astronomy with, I believe it was Bill Whitesell was his last name, right? Yeah, who was hilarious, and I loved him. It was a great experience, and he made learning about, the cosmos very exciting and fun. But when I was working at Apple, and I decided I was going to go back to pursue a PhD, I started taking night classes at Santa Monica College. So I took classes Monday through Thursday and used that to kind of, I did that for two semesters and used that to kind of build up my science background.
Sweet. Good.
No.
It was a great experience too. I'm a big fan of Santa Monica College. I think what they do for the community is tremendous, and community colleges in general. I teach a lot of the students that transfer from these programs, and they, great work that those professors do, and the way that they prepare them for, an institution like UCLA is incredible.
Yeah, so, I think. I agree with you about the community colleges, and for people who are changing their mind, one of my sons went through this, decided later in life he wanted to be an engineer. Community college was important.
Very much. And the professors that are there offer a lot of information too. I remember having a conversation with the chair of the chemistry department. I don't know why I was talking with her, but we were. And she just said, when you get your PhD and you're working on it, you're going to be so focused in one thing, you're going to forget how much you actually have learned. But try to remember that. And she just gave a lot of great advice in this, 30-minute conversation I had. So anyway, lots of great people there.
So Joan, you've got a question?
Yes. So you're teaching now at a major university, and I'm wondering about your teaching style and how you teach and whether that has benefited from having been a student at Antioch. Do you teach differently from your colleagues?
Oh, yes, very much so. That's such a great question. And my colleagues are more about a one-way delivery of information. My approach is it's got to be a two-way street, and I'm more interested in getting students to talk to me and talk out their ideas. and I want to hear from them. I want them to collaborate. The way I teach my ecology class actually is I lecture one day a week, and the way that I do it is I focus on specific examples and use a narrative structure to teach the science. So I use an and but therefore model that helps them connect all of the pieces, and I'm always dialoguing with them and having them talk to one another on that day of lecture. So it's not just me, me, me. And also when they're, you know, asking questions to me, like what is, you know, such and such, I turn it back to them. Like, well, what do you think? I kind of need to know where they are, and I want to understand what they're thinking because they might see something differently. And that might be exciting, right? The second day of lecture, so on the other day, they have gone out on their own and kind of perused news outlets or media sources of some sort to find an article that's related to the current topic of the week. So for example, it could be biodiversity is the topic for the week. And that day that they have to kind of go out and find their own materials, the way it works is they will share, if it's in person, which it traditionally has been, they do a short 3 to 5 sentence summary of the article talking about what's the main research question, what did they find out, and why is it important and relevant. And then they break off into small groups when they come to class and share that with one another. And it gets everybody talking. And it's a way of engaging everybody in the learning process, because then you see everybody has something to offer. They may not have their hand up all the time, and they may not be the one always answering questions, but everybody can contribute. And then what happens is I just call on people randomly or ask people who has a really exciting, interesting idea from their paper that they found, their article that they found. It doesn't have to be primary literature. And we just get the ball going. Let's talk about these ideas. Let's talk about this. And I think what was unique about Antioch is you had to explain where you were coming from. Like, what is your perspective and what is that based on? And that's what I need them to do with science, because the biggest thing I've noticed with undergraduates today is they can't communicate their ideas clearly. I attribute that to two things: not being able to do it in the classroom, but also all of the way that they convey their ideas through text and very short snippets of ideas. It's incredibly frustrating. I think Antioch really set me up for that. And, you know, I've been honored to receive teaching awards and recommendations because of this model. And so I really, you know, I bring this up in class. One of the things I do is say, you know, I went to this very liberal arts school, very small, like there are more students in this class than were on my campus at a given time. And, you know, here's why it was so incredible. And, you know, the idea of being narratively evaluated instead of being given a grade. I really don't give them tests either. I make them write essays, which I think was crucial to being a strong analytical person after Antioch. Your professor's making you write so much. So yeah, I feel like it's totally ingrained in who I am as a professor for sure. Oh, and they are really weirded out by it at first, by the way. Of course. Yes.
That's great. I'm so glad that you do it that way.
Thanks, Joan.
Thank you, Joan. We've got time for one more question. I see David Hall. Do you have that question? You want to bring that up?
Actually, I had two questions. One is, how much time do you have to spend writing proposals to get grants to do research? And the other question is, did they, when you were at Apple, tell you about the company called General Magic? Have you heard of General Magic?
I do not know General Magic. Should I?
Yeah, I think you'd be very interested, as many others would be. And there's a documentary film about General Magic, which is available through Canopy.
Okay. Canopy. Yeah.
Watch that. I think you'll be interested.
Okay.
And it might help you understand what you ran into when you were at Apple.
Okay. I'm very intrigued now. I will look for it on Canopy. To answer your first question, which was, I'm spacing out on it. I'm sorry. This always happens with two
parts. How much of your time do you have to spend writing grants?
Well, I do write some grants, but I've been really fortunate where I ended up in a very cush position at UCLA. My current role is broken into various parts that come from different funding sources. This is how it goes in R1s. You've got these piecemeal approaches to funding. And so I am not on soft money right now, but if I were to, I do write grants so that I can basically do whatever I want. And I'm not on soft money right now, but the way my funding works to administer Stunt, that's 50% of my funding. And the other 50% is teaching. So the nice thing is both say that you have to do research as well. So when I'm not administering or teaching, I have kind of carte blanche to do whatever sort of research I want. And I'm wondering if I could share my screen real quick and just leave you with like three really cool things about amphibians and LA biodiversity. Just show you some pictures so you can stop looking at my face and hearing me talk. I do have graduate students, and I do have undergraduates. I have about 16 undergraduates that I mentor every year. I have a lab space that I work with them. And let's see, can I share? Yeah, okay. Let's see. So this is the poison dart frog I was talking about. And you can see on its back here, it has the tadpole. Mm-hmm. This is a male. The males typically move the larvae, the tadpoles, around. And this is Peter knew this frog quite well, and I don't know how he did. We'll have to figure this out, a little quiz later. But they're often called the strawberry poison dart frog, and you can see why, because of the red with the black dots. But they also get called blue jeans frog too, because they tend to have these blue legs. The whole idea with this coloration is that it's called aposematism, which means I'm bright, and I'm bright because I'll kill you if you try to consume me or eat me. So they have these vibrant colors because they don't have to blend in because they're so poisonous. This is that crater I was talking about, the bubble, the lava bubble that collapsed. And this is one of only like six or seven sites that exist on these plateaus. And this little space over here, that's the stone house we stayed in, and we camped outside. And this would have been their fall when we were there working. And it was about 40 centigrade in the day, and then it dropped down to about 15 to 10 centigrade at night, and it was super windy. But it was such a cool sight. I saw flamingos in these waters, just a really cool, special place. These are the newts that I study. And they do this very strange mating behavior. Instead of competing like head on, they actually form these mating balls is what they're called. And that's how they compete for a mate, is there will be a whole bunch of males with one female. She's in amplexus here, amplexus meaning the male is trying to hold on and court her. And all these males are trying to disrupt that. And one thing you may already know about amphibians or newts is that they have incredible regenerative capabilities. So this newt has lost its eye, but it's already begun to regenerate it. They can have their vertebral column severed and they will refuse it in a matter of months. So newts are actually a very important model organism for understanding like regeneration from a biomedical perspective. But they're also extremely poisonous, which most people don't know. So again, this bright coloration is because they have this neurotoxin in poison glands. A defining characteristic of all amphibians is that they have these poison glands. You can kind of see it on its skin, on its back here. And that's part of what I did for my PhD, is I worked with an analytical chemist and we developed a way to quantify how much toxin was in these little skin samples that I would take from their dorsolateral area. And I developed this little skin biopsy protocol to collect the skin sample without having to bring the animals into captivity. They're actually recognized as a species of special concern in Southern California. They're numbers, their population numbers are declining rapidly. And part of that is because of invasive crayfish that you see here. These crayfish were introduced by humans to many sites. They're actually a globally invasive species and they become very aggressive and they will consume and kill basically anything that's in a habitat that they invade. So the LA River is here, and the LA River is a project I've been working on with Amigos de los Rios to restore that habitat and remove crayfish and other introduced species. So lots of things we could talk about if you're ever interested in how you can contribute besides just recycling, as Peter has said in the past. We can go down to some of the streams and go trap some crayfish.
That sounds fascinating. I'm sure we'll get some takers from that.
Good.
You can reply to any of the those emails that you get from me. They all come into my email box, and we can organize something. The weather's beautiful. Future's looking bright. So I think we can get a small group of people together that would like to do that.
I would love that too.
Well, let's see if there's, I don't think there's any more questions. Thanks for the slides. I forgot that we're going to show you those. So thanks for bringing those in. I think they're a really nice way to end the conversation.
So, I figured, yeah, you can see what I'm talking about actually.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. Well, so I'd like to thank you, first of all, for your time. And I'd like to thank Jesse for being in the control booth there, and for Joan and Wendy for everything that they've done to bring this along. Tanya, obviously, she's the second in command here. So it's a great, great resource and a help. You know, I think As I've said before, I've been trying for over a year to get this up and running about 2 years ago, and really didn't start to get together until I had the help of the college and Wendy and Tanya and a couple of other people who aren't here today. So thank you again. We'll do this again next month. And I hope you can all join us again.